This lecture is on agency theory. I'm your professor, Dr. Stephen Haggard. An agent is a person engaged by another person to act on their behalf. The managers at a firm are agents of the owners of the firm. And the early research in finance and economics makes the assumption that managers always act to maximize the welfare of the owners of the firm. Now, if you've had any experience with human beings at all, you'll know that's not correct because people tend to act in their own rational self-interest. And that rational self-interest may or may not perfectly align with the interests of the managers. And so you wind up with what we call the agency problem, and that is where the desires of the managers are different than the desires of the owners. And the costs associated with this problem we refer to as agency costs. Now, sometimes people say, oh, you're being too pessimistic about the human race and people are really basically good and this would never be a problem. Managers will always act on the behest of their owners of the firm. Let's put that to the test. Picture yourself with your friends. You're all splitting a pizza. There's one piece of pizza left. Who do you think deserves the pizza? Most people would say themselves, and if you're being honest, you would too, unless you don't like pizza. Let's do another example here. You have a job where you go around and visit customers, and to do so, you drive your car. And one day your boss sees your car, it's a beat up Toyota Corolla with an oil leak. And he says, that's terrible, you can't be driving around to see my clients in that car. He said, we're going to get a new car for you. And so you get into his car and you're driving down to the mile of cars, which every town has. This is where all the car dealers are. And on the way there, you're picturing in your head the car that you want. Now, first assume that the manager is going to pay for the car for you. What kind of car do you picture in your head? Now that you have that fixed, I'm going to give you some bad news. As you're cruising to the mile of cars, your boss says, by the way, you're paying for this. Did the car you have pictured in your head change? If it did, then you actually have just experienced the agency problem. It doesn't mean you're a bad person. It means you're normal. Human beings tend to act in their own rational self-interest. Now let's talk about the big questions in agency theory. The first one is, how does the agency problem manifest itself? And wasteful spending is the easiest one that we see here. We know that people are less careful with other people's money than with their own. And we see this is also true with managers. They are less careful with the company's money, which is actually the shareholders' money, than they are with their own. We also see empire building, where managers grow the firm either organically or through acquisition in a way that doesn't increase the wealth of the shareholders, but does increase their own power and prestige. Then we have shirking. Shirking is the opposite of working, and we've all been guilty of it at one time or another. But I can tell you one thing with certainty. You're more certain to shirk when you're working for someone else than when you are working for yourself. And finally, we have risk reduction. We know in finance that risk and reward must go together. For a company to make money, then, for its shareholders, it must take risks. Otherwise, they might as well invest their money in United States Treasury bills and collect the risk-free rate. However, it's not always in the best interest of managers to take risks because they have their entire human capital invested at the one firm. And we'll talk about why that's a problem here in a moment. So these are the things that we see generally as a result of the agency problem. However, these are not the only problems. We have just listed a few here. The next big question is, how can we control the agency problem? And our first go-to is the managerial compensation contract. We want to design the compensation contract so that managers only get rich when shareholders get rich. There's also the managerial labor market. People typically don't think of CEOs as labor, but they are. Anybody, including myself, who trades their time for money is labor. And there's a market for that labor for CEOs. There are people competing for those jobs. And if you engage in the agency problem too much, you'll develop a reputation in the CEO labor market. And after your current position, you will not be able to land another position. And so this tends to act as a constraint on people's agency behavior. Then there's the market for corporate control. If the manager does a poor enough job, the share price will drop low enough and the company will become an attractive takeover target. And simply by buying up the shares of the firm and firing the current manager and replacing them with a competent manager, one can make a whole lot of money. And so this constant threat of takeover in the market for corporate control helps to constrain some of the agency behavior we might see on the part of managers. And then finally, there is monitoring. Monitoring is simply watching. If someone is watching you, you are far more likely to behave properly than if nobody is watching. And it's true with managers too. Remember, managers are just people, just like you, and they respond to the same incentives and penalties that you do. Our first reading for this unit is Jensen and Meckling, 1976, which many consider to be the granddaddy of all agency papers. But in fact, Jensen and Meckling start out by quoting Adam Smith, my favorite Scottish economist, from 1776. And so this paper was at least 200 years in the making. I actually had the pleasure of driving Michael Jensen from Columbia, Missouri to St. Louis one time after he finished speaking at the University of Missouri. And it was one of the most valuable 2 hours of my life because I was able to spend some time with one of the fathers of modern finance. I cover figure one in the next slide of this presentation from this paper. And the reason that I do is because it is not necessarily easy for people to understand if they have not recently had an economics class. So I thought it would be valuable for you if I took some time to go over that. The next paper is Amahud and Lev from 1981. And Amahud and Lev take the agency thought one step further when they talk about how managers have undiversified human capital invested with the firm. And the only way they can reduce the risk of that investment is to reduce the risk of the firm. And one way that we can reduce the risk of the firm is through conglomerate merger. Remember, conglomerate merger is where we take dissimilar businesses and put them together. And just like taking dissimilar stocks and holding them in the same portfolio eliminates some risk, conglomerate mergers do the same. However, we shall see that Amahud and Lev argue that this may or may not be in the best interest of the shareholders. And then finally, we have another paper from Michael Jensen from 1986, where he talks about the problem of free cash flow. Free cash flow is the money that's left over after paying all your bills and investing in every single positive net present value project currently available to the firm. And Jensen argues that when there is lots of free cash flow, we have to worry about managers wasting it. And he talks about several remedies for this free cash flow problem and gives some really good examples of how this free cash flow problem manifests itself in the real world. This is Figure 1 from Jensen and Meckling, 1976, and it may look a little busy and convoluted at first, but we'll walk through it piece by piece. But I do hope you remember what you learned in your economics classes about indifference curves and budget constraints and so on. Let's start by talking about the axes. On the vertical axis, we have firm value and wealth. Under the assumptions of Jensen and Meckling, firm value and wealth are identical for the owners of the firm. And on the horizontal axis, we have the market value of the stream of managers' expenditures on non-pecuniary benefits. Pecuniary benefits are cash. So non-pecuniary benefits would be things like the comforts of the office, the esteem of the community, things like that. So things that don't necessarily provide the manager with money, but they do provide the manager with benefit, or what we would refer to as utility. I will use the term perquisites in exchange for non-pecuniary benefits as we talk here. So if I say either one of those things, you'll know what I'm talking about. First, let's start with the budget constraint. The budget constraint is what two things are being traded off, what's possible. And in the case where the manager owns 100% of the firm, basically every dollar of non-pecuniary benefit they choose to consume reduces firm value by $1. Therefore, the slope of this line, which is that budget constraint, is negative 1. If they choose to consume no perquisites whatsoever, the value would be V bar. And if they choose to consume level F of perquisites, the value of the firm would be 0. In truth, what happens is somewhere in the middle of that line. And how does that get determined? Well, we need to look at what does the manager want? What do they desire? And the way we do that is with some a construction called the indifference curve. And U1, U2, and U3 are indifference curves. The manager is equally happy at any point along any of these curves. But some curves are better than others. The further up and to the right you go, the happier the manager is. So the manager would prefer to be on U1. But if they couldn't be on U1, they'd be fine being on U2. But they would prefer being on U2 to being on U3. And by all means, there are many, many, many of these curves along the way. We've just shown three of them here for sake of illustration. Okay, so how do we figure out how much the manager is going to choose to consume in non-pecuniary benefits? What we're looking for is a utility indifference curve that is tangent to the budget constraint. Tangent to means touching in only one place. And we can see that U2 is tangent to line V bar F at point D. And so this is the spot that would make the manager happiest given the constraint. Now, undoubtedly, there are indifference curves that will intersect this line in other places. In fact, we can see that U3 intersects it down here. But keep in mind that the manager is happier with indifference curves that are further up and more to the right. And so U2 will make the manager happier than U3, so therefore they choose to be at D. You could have indifference curves intersect at more than one point, but of course they would be lower and to the left than U2. So we would not consider them. We want this point that's where it's exactly tangent. And so we know now that the manager, if they own 100% of the firm, they will choose to operate at point D, where they consume F star in non-pecuniary benefits, and the value of the firm at that point is V star. Notice the value of the firm has to be lower than it would be if they didn't consume any non-pecuniary benefits. And so they're willing to put up with a reduction in their wealth for the happiness they can receive from consuming F star in non-pecuniary benefits. So far, we have assumed that this is a one-owner firm, and that owner owns 100%, and therefore they bear 100% of the costs of their consumption of non-pecuniary benefits. So there is no agency problem yet. However, what if the owner investor decided that they wanted to sell a portion of the firm to outsiders? Let's say they wanted to sell 1 minus alpha, where alpha is somewhere between 0 and 1. They want to sell 1 minus alpha to outsiders, and that would mean that they keep alpha. So just for the sake of our little experiment here, let's say that alpha is 0.7. That would mean that they're keeping 70% of the firm and selling 30% of the firm to outsiders, because 1 minus 0.7 is 0.3. If that were the case, and the outsiders figured that the manager would maintain their same level of non-pecuniary benefit consumption, then the outsiders would be willing to pay 1 minus alpha times V star for their share of the firm. But there's a problem. The manager's behavior is not going to stay the same. And the reason is this. In the new situation, when the manager wastes a dollar on non-pecuniary benefits, it only costs him or her 70 cents. Why? Because they only own 70% of the firm. And so now they will be incentivized to consume more of these non-pecuniary benefits because they cost them less. In fact, we can see that the slope of the new budget constraint line is negative alpha. It was negative 1 because for every dollar wasted, a dollar was lost to the manager. But now, for every dollar that's wasted, only alpha gets lost. In our example, 70 cents. And so we have this line, we know the slope of it, and we know that the line must pass through D, because this is where he was at previously and where the investors expected him to stay. Now we have a new line here that starts at V1 and goes to P1, and that is going to be the new budget constraint for the manager. Now, here's the interesting thing. Note that that intersects or is tangent to U1, which is a higher level of happiness for the manager than U2 was. But in order for that manager to achieve this higher level of happiness, they have to move their consumption of non-pecuniary benefits from point D over here to point A. Well, that sounds fine, except for one thing. What does that actually do to the value of the firm? If we go back to the old budget constraint and look at the value from there, we can see that now the firm is really only worth V0. Why is it worth less? Because the manager has increased his or her consumption of non-pecuniary benefits from F star to F0, and in doing so has reduced the value of the firm. The manager might assume that outside investors are stupid, but we see that usually anyone that has managed to accumulate money has a little bit of rational thought process, and they will know in advance that the manager is going to behave in this way. And so rationally, when they purchase a piece of the firm, 1 minus alpha, they're only willing to pay V0 times 1 minus alpha, not V star 1 minus alpha. And so the owner will receive less in exchange for the 1 minus alpha share of the firm than they might have thought. And in the end, what this says to us is that the person who bears the cost for this increase in non-pecuniary benefit consumption is the manager, not the outside investor, so long as the outside investor is rational and is only willing to purchase the firm, the share of the firm, at a discount, in this case 1 minus alpha times v sub 0 instead of 1 minus alpha times v star.